So, the homework is available, and as I mentioned, I have a dissertation defense at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. Unclear how long this is going to go. And then I have a meeting up in Scholes Hall at 11:30. So, we'll see what we can do. If we don't have our problem session tomorrow, I'm available with lots of flexibility on Monday. So we'll pull around and see when people are available. Okay. All right then. So what we are talking about, what we have begun to talk about, and we'll continue to talk about through the remainder of this semester, is the problem of open quantum system dynamics. So this is the problem of thinking about the dynamics of a quantum system which is open to the environment, for which there is a coupling to other degrees of freedom that are not part of our system that we call the environment, okay? And this problem, as we discussed, is intimately related to lots of important questions in quantum mechanics, including how we treat energy dissipation, relaxation in a quantum system, relaxation to equilibrium, but is also intimately related to not only that kind of thermodynamical classical relaxation, but also some intrinsically quantum questions like how is quantum coherence lost in a system? How does a system lose its capacity to exhibit interference between alternative histories? That is a problem that is solvable within quantum mechanics. Okay? That's not the unanswerable question of what is a measurement. That's a different question. And we will see that quantum mechanics predicts that when a system is coupled to environment, it will lose coherence, generally. Okay? We will study that problem very soon. The problem of measurement is also intimately related to that because, of course, a measuring device itself is a system that is at some level quantum and is coupled to the thing that we're trying to measure. So there is some exchange of information between the system and the measuring device. So there's some relation there to the question of measurement. And those are interesting, and we'll try to tie them together best we can through the course of our discussion. All right? What we're then talking about, these dynamics, we're now thinking about the most general kind of dynamical evolution we can have in quantum mechanics, okay? And that kind of evolution we call a dynamical map. It's sometimes called a quantum channel. It's another name that we can give to the same thing. Or a quantum process. So people will talk about a quantum process. It all means the same thing. There's an input-output map that maps some initial state or some input state to some final state. The notion of a quantum channel obviously is thinking about this in a kind of communications notion where, you know, we have like an optical fiber and we send in a photon. And, you know, there's a communication channel is where the term quantum channel comes from. But now we've abstractified, in my favorite new word, this notion to just sort of an input-output map. And the general properties of such a map are listed here. These maps, well, it must be convex linear if we're going to think about this in terms of states, but then we can easily extend it to be an overall linear map where A and B are arbitrary scalars, which means that A, this script B A here, is what we call a super operator. That's to say it's a matrix. If this is if rho lives in a d-dimensional Hilbert space, it's a d by d matrix, then script dA here is a d squared by d squared matrix, okay? That maps states to other states, okay? What we call a super operator. We want this to take states to states, so that is to say, states are physical, they have positive eigenvalues, then the output state must also have positive eigenvalues. And we didn't really prove this in any way, but in order for this to really make sense, it must be the case that if my system is coupled to some other reference system, some other degrees of freedom, that and there's some joint density matrix on the two, that if the environment only couples to this but not to that, well, that should also be a positive matrix, no matter how many extensions I make. And that's what's called complete positivities. Okay? So another name for these kinds of maps, dynamical maps, you will hear them called, if you really want to be sophisticated, a CP map, which is a completely positive map. Okay? And moreover, we didn't really prove this either, but we stated that these maps must be trace non-increasing. And if they preserve the trace, then we say they're trace preserving, and sometimes these are called CPTP maps, or completely positive trace preserving maps. You will see that in literature as well. That's just TP my CP. All right, so now what we proved, well, we didn't prove it, but it's we sort of just sort of sketched out a rule that if the map is of this form, which is called the Krauss decomposition, then you can quickly see that it is of this, it satisfies all these properties. Okay, you can check that for yourself fairly easily. Maybe it should be a homework problem. But it goes both ways. That is to say, if any map that satisfies these properties is a Krauss map. Okay? And these operators, M, are the Krauss operators, and the trace non-increasing property can be expressed easily this way. And when this is equal to one, this is a trace preserving map. So we saw how one can obtain this in a physical model whereby the system and environment are coupled together. And if this is all the degrees of freedom that are in that for which the evolution happens, then that evolution is unitary. Okay? And thus we describe, say, a time evolution whereby the joint system environment evolution evolves according to this some unitary map. Now, we can always get this Krauss map, it turns out, always by choosing the environment to be in some initial pure state. Although that might not be the physical thing that's happening, in which case we would write down, say, a mixed state, a thermal state, which would be a more likely state for the environment. But we can always get a Krauss map by choosing a pure state for the environment. There exists some pure state for which it would represent this map. And sometimes it is a pure state, like in the case we'll study of a atom decay in the quantum mechanical vacuum, which is a pure state. Okay. Then I have some initial system state, which is uncorrelated, and so my evolution here was given by this. So this is the overall evolution of the joint system plus environment, right? And thus the state of the system at a later time is given by tracing out, and that was equal to our Krauss decomposition. This is my map that maps the state of the system at time zero to later time t, where these Krauss operators were given by the partial matrix element of the generally entangling evolution between the system and the environment, partial matrix element between the initial state of the environment and some other set of states which constitute some basis of states on the environment. And if it's all states, then that's a trace preserving map. Yes, sir?
So if the environment starts in a mixed state, so there's a statistical mixture of pure states?
Yep.
There will be a Krauss operator for each pure state in the superposition?
We can write that as a convex combination of other Krauss state, Krauss operators, but we can sort of recombine them all into one overall Krauss map.
Okay.
There's sort of two different pictures that we're giving here. One is a kind of abstract question of general axioms of the nature of the map. And I haven't really proven this. It's discussed in more detail. We don't really have time to do it in the notes I posted from Caves' quantum information theory course, which you can prove that if the map satisfies this problem, then it has of this form, and any map of this form can always be derived in what's called a measurement model, which is what I just wrote down here. Now, there's a different question, which is to say, let's say physically there was some environment that was in some state. It was not a pure state. It, too, would have a Krauss decomposition. But there exists some other pure state which would be exactly the same map. Okay, that's just a subtle mathematical connection. Because there always exists some pure state for which I could do this. It wouldn't be the physical one, but it would represent the same map. Because we talked about last time the non-uniqueness of the Krauss map. I can remix, I can have what's called a remixing of the Krauss operators to find a new set of Krauss operators through some partial isometry, which could be a unitary, but it doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to have the same number of nus as mus. And as long as the rows and columns of this rectangular matrix are orthogonal, which is what it means to be a partial isometry, or orthonormal, then the Krauss map, or writing this as a sum over nus, is exactly the same map. we're going to come back, this is an extremely important point, that the map doesn't determine what the Krauss operators are. There's a uncountably infinite number of different Krauss operators that lead to the same input-output map. As we discussed at the end of the lecture last time, with that, really in this measurement model, and we're going to really come back to that measurement model again at the end of the semester, corresponds to, well, one way it could correspond to, are different basis sets for the environment. When we traced out the environment, it didn't matter what basis set we used. But if somehow we have access to the environment, well, then it's a different story. So we'll come back to that. Hold that thought for the future. Okay? All right, good. So, now, what we have discussed here in this formalism is, again, sort of input-output, time t equals zero to some later time. But kind of the physics of how that dynamics is generated is kind of buried. It's buried in what generated U in the first place. So, from the physics perspective, what we're often most interested in is not necessarily the U for, say, unitary dynamics, but the Hamiltonian, which is the generator of differential dynamics in time, so that we can get a differential equation. The interactions, the physical interactions which make things happen, happen in differential time, not the overall input-output. So from the physics point of view, we really want to know more about not just the overall, what happened at time zero to what happens in later time, but how did it get there? So what we want to talk about is the generator of open quantum system dynamics. Okay. So to do that, let's first remind ourselves about the generator of closed quantum system dynamics. So for a closed quantum system, we have unitary dynamics. And we could ask, what is the unitary evolution that takes us from some time t to some time t plus dt? What is that? Well, if this is a differential, then we can say this is going to be closed. When dt goes to zero, that's not doing anything. That's the identity. It's what we call a near identity evolution. So we write this to differential order dt as 1 plus something proportional to dt, and that something is the Hamiltonian, and the units of h bar. So this is h, right? So that's my generator of unitary dynamics. Of course, we can write this, if we wanted to solve for the unitary evolution itself, this says if I want to go from time 0, t equals 0, to that, well, that is, first I go from 0 to t, and then I go from t to t plus dt. Right. And plugging that in, Hamiltonian itself might depend on time, so I'll leave it as general as possible. Could be some external classical field that is time dependent. And so that equals that. So that tells, that gives me that like subtract that from that, I get the derivative of u with respect to t is equal to. And so that's a Schrodinger equation. If you haven't seen it, you should have seen it. That's how you get. Now, of course, the solution to this tells me that the unitary evolution is the time ordered product of the integral generally Hamiltonian if it's time dependent. And if it's time independent, I have the usual exponentiation of Hamiltonian, right? I can also, so this is the overall time evolution map for closed clumps. We can write this as a differential equation for the state itself, a Schrodinger equation for how the state evolves. So if I want to say my state at time t plus dt is the time evolution operator, the unitary transformation taking it from time t to time t plus dt and plugging in my differential form for that and keeping terms only to order dt, what I get is that, right? Which is the Schrodinger equation written in terms of density matrix form. If I subtract from that, divide by dt, I get the Schrodinger equation for the density matrix. Right? Now, this we can think about as an input-output map on growth, right? This is some A, which is a function of the initial time and the differential that acts on the state. It's a super operator acting on the density operator. And that's of a particular form in this case. A is equal to the identity map. Well, it's not, right? Plus, or I can write it as, if I want, I can write it as add. Okay, so this add thing is the adjoint Lie representation, if you want to be super fancy. All it is add on rho is the commutator of H with rho. And that's a linear map on Europe. Okay? So this is an example of a dynamical map that is the generator of unitary time evolution. Okay? Now what we're interested in is writing the like more general differential map, a map that takes the state at time t to a state at time dt later, which isn't necessarily the generator of unitary time evolution, but is some generator of a CP map, a more general CP map. In particular, we're going to be interested in CPTP maps. So now that's a generally hard problem, but we can restrict ourselves to a particular subclass of dynamics. So let's just postulate a particular form of the dynamics and see what that form must look like. So we're going to postulate a form that we're going to call Markovian open quantum system dynamics. What does that mean? Well, it means the following. That we're going to postulate the following form, that the map which takes the system from time t to a time t plus dt, when acting on the state at time t, well, it's for dt goes to zero, it's got to get me back to that, and then it's proportional to dt. But I'm going to say that that is only some map that only depends on rho at time t, and doesn't depend on rho at any other time. So it looks like this, camera one, right? It looks like this, where this was my thing. But it's more general than that, because I'm not saying this is the commutator with the Hamiltonian, but there's something there, which we'll call the Lindladian. We'll explain what the hell Lindlad was. Well, sorry, Lindlad, I don't know if he's still around, but anyway. It's not the Hamiltonian, but at least it might contain a Hamiltonian, because better include unitary time evolution as a special case. But it's going to have to be more general than that. And the fact that it's Markovian, and we'll explain what that means more general, is that it only depends, that this map only depends on rho, the input rho, rho at time t. And not the whole history of rho. We'll explain why, how it possibly could depend on anything more than that, why this is an assumption about the nature of the dynamics and not just blatantly obvious. Why, of course it depends only on that. Okay, so this is a statement of Markovian, this is a mathematical statement of Markovian dynamics. Okay, now if this is going to be a CP, actually before I do that, let me just say, so this can be expressed to say, I can write this in a similar form to the way I wrote I could write equivalently a differential equation here. This says, this is my state at time t plus d. Right. So this is saying that the state evolves according to a differential equation where this is my Lindladian acting on this. Okay? When this was minus I h bar at h, this was the Schrödinger equation. But this is now a more general equation, which is called the master equation, which comes from a statistical mechanics term for how populations of in a probability distribution evolve dynamically. That's also called a master equation. This is the quantum generalization thereof. Equivalently, we can write this as an equation for the superoperator, which says that the superoperator evolves according to this, the generator. So the Lindladian is the generator of dynamics. just like the Hamiltonian was, for a closed quantum system, this is the generator, okay? And this composed with A. That's my differential equation. I can write this, could be thought of as a differential equation for the matrix. That's the superoperator. And that equation then just says that the superoperator is the prime ordered exponential of the Lindblad-ian, just like we had before. And if the Lindblad-ian is independent of time, then it's just that. The Lindblad-ian is itself a supermatrix, right? It's a matrix that takes operators to operators. So the Lindblad-ian itself could be expressed as a d squared by d squared matrix. When I exponentiate that, I get the superoperator, script dA. All right. So, with that said, we can now ask ourselves, what is the Lindblad-ian? What form must it take? Well, we know that if this is a physical map that came from the interaction with an environment in some way, that it was approximately Markovian. But regardless, it is a CP map, and we're going to consider it to be one where we keep all of the degrees of freedom, so it's a CPTP map. Which means that whatever this map is, can be expressed as a Krauss form, in a Krauss decomposition, with Krauss operators that take me from time t to time t plus dt. Okay? And this has to be equal to this. So we can ask ourselves, what are the form of the Krauss operators that can give me Markovian dynamics? Well, there's one Krauss operator that has to be such that when it goes, at least one Krauss operator, that when dt goes to zero, the Krauss operator becomes the identity, right? It's got to be one of them that's like a near identity map, just like the unitary, right? So we'll call that M0, which we'll say is the identity operator, plus whatever else we want, some other operator that could depend on time dt. Okay, we're not yet said what g is, but when dt goes to zero, this goes to the identity. So that's one, at least one, and that takes account for the fact that we have this term in the map, right? Because when I conjugate that, I'm gonna get one of the terms is gonna be rho, right? You could just see M0 dagger, or M0 rho, that's equal to rho t plus g of t rho of t plus rho of t with t dagger dt. Keeping the terms only to order dt. What else could I have as a Krauss operator? Well, I could have this. Something that's proportional to the square root of dt. And that, I'll just say whatever's left over, I'll call that L. So for all other mu's greater than zero, This has to be the form. Because if I conjugate this, it can add to anything else that will be proportional to dt, mu rho mu dagger is equal to L mu rho L mu dagger dt. And that's a perfectly good thing that can add into this. Right? We've already taken into account the identity part, but we can add anything else we like that's proportional to dt, and that's perfectly good. In fact, we must have that, because it's got to be the case, if this is going to be trace preserving, that the sum of these guys, we want all of them to add to the identity for trace preserving. Okay? These operators, L, are called the Lindblad or jump operators. The notion of a quantum jump, we'll see how that's related at all to the notion of the Lindblad operators. But they are called the jump operators or the Lindblad operators. So, given this, we see that, so given the trace condition that this sums to 1, well, that is equal to M0 dagger M0 plus mu equals 1 to whatever the total number of this way. Right? And that's equal to, this is supposed to equal the identity, the trace preserving. That's equal to the identity plus G dagger BT. That's M0 dagger M0, keeping terms to only order dt, plus the sum over mu equals 1 to mu max L mu dagger L mu dt is equal to the identity. Okay, so what we see then is the following. First of all, this operator is Hermitian, right? So is this. I'm not saying whether G is Hermitian or not, but its Hermitian part must, I can equate the Hermitian part and the anti-Hermitian part of the problem, right? So what this tells me then is the following. That I claim that g of t is equal to minus a half the sum of mu over mu equals 1 to mu max L mu dagger L mu plus some a where a is anti-Hermitian. How do we see that? Well, if I this plus its dagger, the anti-Hermitian part cancels. The Hermitian parts cancel this. That's the most general form of this operator. And since this is anti-Hermitian, I can always write A as I times the Hermitian operator, right? And by convention, we call it the Hamiltonian, a minus I in front. So H, I mean, the fact that I factor out an H bar in my sign is just because I want to connect this in the case where we have closed quantum system dynamics, that this is the Hamiltonian. So H is the Hamiltonian. And so what this tells me is that M0 is equal to 1 minus I over H bar H dt minus a half the sum over mu, and I'm going to stop writing all the limits, which is whatever the sum is. So it's a generalization of the unitary generator. It has this piece in it that's different. And all the other mu's, we said, were mu. Yeah. All of these in principle could be functions of time, but I'm going to be lazy and not write that explicitly. Okay? So, given that, what is the master equation? So the master equation. So we have rho at t plus dt is equal to the sum over mu, mu equals 0 to mu max, the Krauss map. Plug in our expression here, and I get the following. Well, this term gives me just what we had before for unitary dynamics, right? And then I'm going to get this. So then I get this sum over mu minus a half L mu dagger L mu rho. And then the dagger of that is the same. Okay? And then I get plus L mu rho L mu dagger. And there should have been a dt here. Right? Or, to really piss you off, get rid of this, write this as a d rho dt, and erase the dt's. This is an equation you will forever remember. Not as much as you remember the normalized form of the Gaussian. I forgive you if you didn't remember the Lindblad form of the master equation, but not much. I only kind of forgive you, because if you've taken my course, you must know the Lindblad form of the master equation. Everyone, this is so important. This is the most general master equation one can write that is Markovian. So if, I mean, we derive this from first principles, from the point of view of if the dynamics was Markovian, and we wrote down what that meant, that the generator only told us about rho at t and not the whole history, then it must be of this form. So Lynn Bradford, the master equation, is the only master equation that is the Markovian dynamics that gives a CP, TP map. There is a slight modification of this, or not a modification, but another way that we often, and we will in this course, express this by going back to this picture over here of M0. So I can look at this M0 again and write M0 in the following way. 1, factor out the minus I over H bar and write this as some effective Hamiltonian dT. Okay? Where H effective, maybe I should write this higher on the board. Is equal to h minus I h bar over 2 sum over mu Helmgadner L mu. So what can we say about h effective? Well, first of all, h effective is non-Hermitian. It has a Hermitian part and an anti-Hermitian part. You like a real part and imaginary part. Now, you may remember, those of you who studied this last year, that we did look, I mean, this is not the first time you've seen the Lindblad math equation, problem set 5 or something, homework, quantum mechanics, and quantum optics, dig it out. You'll have a little amnesia. You say, oh yeah, let's do that. And we had this whole business about the imaginary part of the Hamiltonian having to do with the decay relative, so something has a finite lifetime, we can take into account that decay by putting an imaginary part into the energy eigenvalue in the same way that we put an imaginary part into an index of refraction to account for absorption, for example. So that's intimately related here. This anti-Hermitian part, as we'll see in a moment, is related to the decay of the system, if you like. So another way that we often write this master equation is as follows. Okay. It's a commutator with H effective, but there's this prime on here, which is to say that this is not the normal commutator, that this is equal to H effective rho minus rho H effective dagger. Okay, that is just a shorthand. And once you take the dagger, then, well, if the Hermitian part's the same, but the anti-Hermitian part then adds. And then you get this. Okay. But we will see this division is extremely useful. As we will see in a moment, what we had, this part of the master equation came from the M0 Krauss operator. And this part was all the rest of them. And they lead to different physical effects. All right. try to build a little bit of physical intuition about what all this stuff, I mean, a lot of symbols here. What are we talking about? Well, we'll have more symbols, maybe that won't help, but we'll try. So let's just, first of all, think about, let's look at this equation in the, as a matrix equation, or equation for the matrix elements in some basis. In particular, let's look at the equation of the energy eigenstates of the system Hamiltonian. Okay? So, let's just call them J. Right? So the H on this is some energy eigenvalues. Okay. Now these are the stationary states if I just had the Hamiltonian. But due to the coupling to the environment, these are no longer stationary states necessarily, right? Because the open quantum system, the coupling to the degrees of freedom of the environment, causes the system to evolve, in some way, right? Now, something that's not necessarily obvious, but we will prove probably next week, is that the Lemblatian don't couple populations to coherences. That's to say, coherences are only coupled to coherences, and populations are only coupled to populations through the Lindblad operators. The Hamiltonian is different. The Hamiltonian generates coherences, couples populations, like Rabi oscillations. But we'll see, the Lindbladians, under appropriate conditions, don't do that. Okay? So let's then just look at the equations for how the populations evolve. That's to say, the probability to be in one of these energy eigenstates. So I'll call P sub J the population in state J. So I want to know, how does the population or the probability to be in state J change as a function of time? So I have my master equation. First of all, the first term does nothing because the Hamiltonian doesn't change the population in the stationary state because it's an eigenstate. And you can see that by just, it's an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. Okay, so that commutes. So then we have the other terms. So then we have plus the sum over mu minus a half J L mu dagger L mu rho J plus J rho L mu dagger L mu J plus sum over mu J L mu dagger or L mu rho L mu dagger. Okay. Right. So under this condition that I don't couple populations to coherences and vice versa, I can just look at how the diagonal matrix elements of rho, the other populations couple to this population. Okay. So I'm just going to plug in here, just plug in that there's some over all states, like that, and plug that into this equation. There are, of course, off-diagonal elements, but as I will argue later, they won't couple the populations through the limb diet. Okay? Not obvious, but we'll just take that for now. All right, so when I plug that in, I get the following equation. This then becomes equal to minus something I'm going to call gamma sub j, pj, plus the sum over k, gamma going from k to j times k. Where gamma sub j is equal to the sum over mu j L mu dagger L mu j, right? So when I plug this ansatz into here, then you see I only pick off the j, and then I'm going to get the matrix element, and I get it twice. So that gives me this term, right? And I plug in this ansatz into here, and I get these transition rates is equal to the absolute value squared of mu k squared. No hat on that. Yes?
Is it supposed to be dp dt equals?
This equals, pardon me. Yeah, pardon me. Right. So, this is what we call a population rate equation. It's the kind of equation that we get in population dynamics like rabbits and foxes. Dynamical equations for, that's why they're called populations. It's like the population of species. There is some rate at which the population of species J decreases. And there's some population of rate at which it increases, by which stuff that was in K goes to J, right? So gamma sub J is equal to the rate at which population leaves level J. And this is the transition rate by which population in K feeds J. So population can go from K into J, and that would increase the pot. And it depends how much is in K to start, right, to get there. Or it could just get out of J, go, there's some rate, and then it's exponentially decaying. Notice that this term, the rate at which stuff left level J came from these terms in the master equation, which was the imaginary part of the effective Hamiltonian, or the anti-emission part. Whereas these terms, the feeding terms, were the other, the, you know, mu's in the master equation. Those are the so-called feeding terms. They feed population. Okay? So the picture here is like one that, you know, we think about in laser physics, where we have population rate equations, right? Where we have stuff in different levels, and there's different rates feeding stuff, and then we ask about dynamical evolution of the population. Right? Yes?
Does the non-Markovian equation have a gamma sub j goes to k?
It does. I mean, that's, of course, just the opposite.
Right.
And let us now, and that's important, let's look at, so this is the total population rate at which something leaves J, but something can leave J and go back to that level, right? So let's, this sum is sum over all possible levels, right? Including going back to itself or going to other directions. So let's, first of all, let's look at this guy. Sum over mu. Of that. Now let's take this and insert a complete set. Of course, that includes J itself. This then is equal to what? It's equal to sum over k, sum over, and this should, I'm sorry, this should have had a sum over mu in it, right, from here. Sum over mu k L mu J square. Right? Which is what? It's the sum over K, the rate of transition from J to K. So the total rate at which population leaves level J is the rate at which it goes into all other levels. Okay? That's the rate at which it leaves J. Where does it go? It goes to K. So we can rewrite this equation if I now substitute that in and the terms where it goes back to itself cancel, right? Because this includes, I mean, it was a total sum over all levels, so it included going back to itself, which is a, sometimes a possible thing that we can have. So that tells you that the population, another way of writing this equation is minus sum k not equal to j. It starts in J and goes to some other level. Or it can go from some other level and get J. So that's the total rate equation, right? It says I can either leave level J by going to some other level K, or I can repopulate my level J by coming from some other level K and coming into it.
Do you want the minus sign inside this one?
Do I want the minus sign where?
Inside this one? Or is it?
This minus sign is on this.
Oh, okay.
And this, yeah. Right? So this is the way in which population decays, and this is the way in which population increases. This is the feeding term. Right?
Just to make sure I'm not forgetting something that I wanted to tell you guys. Yeah, so far so good. So let's look at an example, one that we studied last semester, or I should say last fall. That's the royal we, of course. The decay of a two-level atom in the vacuum. So, you know, we have our two-level atom, some excited state, some ground state, and the excited state can decay to the ground state with some rate. That's the Einstein A coefficient, which is also called the spontaneous emission rate. Okay? So, there is, as induced by the vacuum, there is a rate of transition that takes me from G, I mean from E to G, okay, which is the spontaneous emission rate. And that is given by, according to our rule, there's some jump operator, which is why this is called the jump operator, because it's like a quantum jump. Get to that a little bit more technically a little bit later, in what way is spontaneous emission like a quantum jump, that takes you from E to G. And there's only one channel, so there's only one jump operator. On the other hand, there's no spontaneous jump from, so that's zero. Okay. So we can guess what L is. It's something who, when you take its matrix element, also there's, you know, this from E to E is zero, and it doesn't jump from E to G, it's also zero. So what's L?
It's only got one non-zero matrix element.
Of the sigma minus?
Sigma minus, absolutely. So it's something that takes me from E to G, and its magnitude is the square root of gamma. Right? And as Adrian said, in the two-level jargon, that's sigma minus. If we call this spin down and this spin up in the usual pseudo spin denotation. Okay? So, we can write down the master equation. It says that the equation of motion, you might have some Ravi, maybe a laser that's just driving the atom, so I'll allow myself the Hamiltonian. And then I have minus a half gamma, sigma minus, sigma plus, that's L, or sigma plus, sigma minus, is L dagger L, rho, plus rho, sigma plus, sigma minus, plus gamma, that's the master equation for a two-level atom, which we studied last time. Okay. Notice in this problem, if we ask what is the effective Hamiltonian, the non-Hermitian Hamiltonian for the problem in this case. That's H, the Hamiltonian, minus I, Planck's constant over 2 pi, H bar over 2, of a dagger L, right? So we say, which is what in this case? Well, it's the Hamiltonian minus I over H bar over 2, sigma plus sigma minus. Well, what's sigma plus times sigma minus? Sigma minus, we said, was the thing that takes E to G, and sigma plus is the thing that takes G to E. Right? So sigma plus, sigma minus, and I forgot about the gamma. It's in there, right? So H bar gamma over the 2, E. Is that the form we expect? It's exactly the form we expect, right? If we write down H, say, is the Hamiltonian for the atom plus whatever, say, atom-laser interaction, if we wanted to put that in there, we could, or whatever other interaction we wanted. But there's the Hamiltonian for the atom. The Hamiltonian for the atom is the ground state energy plus the excited state energy. So if I look at my H effective, what I have is there's the ground state plus the excited state minus I H bar gamma over 2 E plus whatever interact, whatever else I want to interact with. That's H effective, right? So what has we've done here? What we've done is we've added an imaginary part to the excited state, which has a magnitude of minus H bar gamma over 2. Is that exactly the magnitude we expect? Where does that H bar gamma over 2 come from? Why over 2?
There's is E to G.
Yeah.
Could be. There's something about like from G to E. I forgot exactly what that is.
Yeah. I mean, you're on the right track. I mean, what is this saying? If we just evolved according to a Schrodinger-like equation, suppose let's take this. Let's forget about the interaction. Let's just say we have the atom sitting there in the vacuum, and at some time t equals 0. We have some superposition of ground and excited state. Right? What is the state of a later time? Well, if I just wrote this, what I would get the Hamiltonian, I get a phase factor for G, and I get a complex phase factor for E, which has this now becomes a real, why was it gamma over 2 rather than gamma? Because I'm looking at the problem. If I look at the probability to be in the excited state as a function of time, what is it? It's the square of this amplitude, which is equal to the initial probability e to the minus gamma t. The probability decays as gamma. The probability amplitude decays at half a gamma. Now you notice, because you're very observant, that this isn't, it's not the whole evolution, because of course this is decaying, but if this is decaying, we know that that population must be feeding here. That's because this term, the effect of Hamiltonian, doesn't account for the feeding. The feeding was in the other part of the master equation, this part of the master equation, right? Let's look at what that part of the master equation is. Let's plug it in. So that's gamma sigma minus rho sigma plus, right? Which is equal to gamma of the population in the excited state. So this, we can use that equation. What this is saying is, this is going to be, this is a projector on the ground state, and stuff gets fed into here at this rate, a rate that depends on what was in the excited state. So we can write down the population rate equations for our two-level atom. So what this says, given that equation, this says the rate of change of population in the ground state, well, it depends. I could have some, if I have some interaction relationship, I could, that could be, this would be the Rabi oscillation term would come from this if this had an atom laser interaction, for example. It had no interaction, this would do nothing. This is a stationary state. This term contributes nothing, because this is equal to the projector on the excited state. This is the projector on the excited state, right? Plus gamma of population in the excited state. So whatever's in the excited state can decay to the ground state and feed it. The population in the excited state evolves how? Well, the excited state decays, that's the decay term here, so whatever is in the excited state can decay out. And the second term is nothing, because nothing feeds that. That's the portion of the projector on the ground state. The total population is conserved in this. If I add these two together, I get zero. Okay? Which means that the total population change, the total population is constant at one, and the sum of them doesn't change with time. What about the off-diagonal matrix elements? The coherences. Well, I have perhaps can drive the coherences with some Hamiltonian. What about the first term? Do the coherences decay? So I put in an E on this side and a G on this side. Well, the G on this side does nothing, but the E on this side gives me an E. And so what I get is minus gamma over 2 rho EG. All right, and then the last, there's no feeding of the coherences. So this, we also studied last fall. I'm such an annoying professor. That you have the T1 and T2 times, right? T1 and T2, anyone doesn't remember T1 and T2. This is T2, right? The decay of coherences. And the decay of coherences, you always, if you have decay of population, you always have decay of coherences as well, which happens at half the rate. You could be an additional, we had collisions, we could have extra ways in which the T2 is bigger than T1, but this is it. Good to review all of that. Notice that as promised, although I didn't prove it, this particular case, the dissipative terms don't couple coherences to populations. Right, populations are only coupled to populations, the coherences are only coupled to coherences through these terms. Coherences and populations are mixed together through the Hamiltonian. Very good. We will stop there. If you haven't picked up your homework, it's, some of it's still up here. And I'll let you all know tomorrow when I'm free from dissertation defense.